And on this Sunday afternoon, great shot of what they call the Marilyn Monroe Towers here in Mississauga, Ontario, obviously because of their shapely appearance. And speaking of Mississauga, we're all set for 3 hours of figure skating, including the Dance Free on TSN. And as we come back to the Hershey Center in Mississauga, skaters on the ice behind me, there's Patrick Chan. They're preparing for the gala. You will see the gala in its entirety next Saturday night here on TSN. And on this Sunday afternoon, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Brian Williams. Welcome back to TSN's continuing exclusive coverage of the 2011 Skate Canada International. A real bonus for you skating fans this afternoon as we're on the air for the next 3 hours. Now, the focus later in the show will be the Dance Free. The leaders, no surprise, Tessa Virtue and Scott Moyer, after a sensational short program. Another good story for Canada is that the other team, Caitlin Weaver and Andrew Poget, are standing in second place. Now, a bonus for you today, before we get to coverage of the Dance Free, we are going to recap what has happened here this weekend. We have the ladies program, the 14-year-old jumper from Russia, Lizaveta Tuktamashiva, winning the gold medal there. You will see that. The pairs free, good story for Canada. Megan DeHamel and Eric Radford with a bronze medal. And, of course, Patrick Chan last night winning gold in the men's free. Also, interview, speaking of Patrick Chan, when he's finished rehearsing down on the ice below, he will join me here at the desk, as will Megan DeHamel, Eric Radford, and the CEO of Skate Canada, William Thompson. A busy afternoon, and I tell you, two of the busiest people in this area are going to be our play-by-play crew as we say good afternoon on this Sunday to Rod Black and Tracy Wilson.
Good afternoon, Brian. Hello, Canada. Welcome back to Skate Canada International. It's been a very interesting start to the skating season. As normal, you see some skaters who quite don't have their A game yet. They're peaking towards nationals or Grand Prix final or even to the World Championships. You expect that. What we don't expect is some perfection. We saw that from Javier Fernandez. We'll see that also later in the show as recap the day. But we've also seen some perfection, as you would expect, from Tessa Virtue and Scott Moyer.
Yes, a terrific start to this season for them with their short dance. And remember, Rod, we saw them at an all-time high when they won Olympic gold in Vancouver. All kinds of problems with injuries last season. They missed most of the season, lost their world title. Well, they've come out here healthy, so happy to be competing in the early season, and we're really seeing the joy. It's just evident on the ice, and terrific short program, and they've got a beautiful new free dance in store for us to the music of Funny Face.
And they've been dragging their fellow Canadians along with them in Caitlin Weaver and Andrew Poget. We'll watch them as well today. One and two Canada could be on the podium, and covering those skaters backstage is Sarah Orleski. Sarah.
Well, Rod, as Tracy mentioned when talking about Tessa Virtue and Scott Moore, just the happiness that they have. And that's what really struck me when speaking to them after the short skate, was just how happy they were. Tessa commented on she was just thrilled to not only perform a clean program, a new program for them, but to do it without pain. And that's been the overriding issue for them over these last couple of seasons. She says it's been probably about 3 years since they were able to compete without her being in pain. And they are just thrilled with the opportunity. And the sky's the limit for them now. They are also incredibly excited to debut the free dance. As you mentioned, Funny Face, this is something they debated about for a while. They felt now is the time. They are always looking to reinvent themselves, and they are hoping to take that step forward today.
All right, thank you, Sarah. That is coming up later in the show. Up next, we'll go back and look at the ladies' competition featuring the sensational 14-year-old from Russia.
We are getting ready for the free dance still to come here today on TSN at the 2011 Skate Canada International. Final medals to be awarded. The first medals were awarded yesterday in the ladies' competition.
Well, there was a lot of anticipation for the ladies' event because it was the first senior competition for the young Russian skater, Lizaveta Tukhtomushova. And she did not disappoint in her performances, but she certainly had her hands full with a couple of veteran skaters. One of my favorite from Japan, Akiko Suzuki, and an American skater, Ashley Wagner, who's newly reinvented herself, trying to breathe new life into her career.
They're on the ice getting ready for the gala, which we'll have next week on CTV. But let's take you back to yesterday here at the Hershey Center in Mississauga and the ladies' free... Elizaveta Tukhtomushova of Russia rehearsing the gala, which we will have for you next week on CTV. She's in the gala for one reason, because of what she did here in Mississauga yesterday. Bronze, and there is young Elizaveta, who will be 15, Tracy, in early December. And as much as everybody's talking about Elizaveta Tukhtomushova, and it's kind of hard to talk about that name. But the thing about this is that Russia's been looking for this next star, and they've not only got her, but they've got a couple others.
Yes, they do. They've got a number to draw from, and it will be really interesting to watch how these youngsters progress, and as we said earlier, how the timing affects them going into Sochi. But not good news for the Canadian ladies here, Rod.
No, it wasn't. Disappointing results for the Canadian champion, Cynthia Phaneuf. And we should mention that Joanie Rochette is still on the radar screen, taking it kind of week to week this season, but she's still very much eligible. She's still skating, still wants to skate. Cynthia Phaneuf, Amélie Lacoste, and Adriana DeSantis were way down on the leaderboard here.
Well, sixth for Amélie, seventh for Cynthia Phaneuf, and what the ladies have to do is do some honest assessment of where they're standing at this point of the season and what they're going to do to get themselves back in contention here in these competitions. They do have time, but it's going to take a lot of soul searching and a lot of work.
Good news is it's early in the season. Free dance still to come. The gala rehearsal going on behind us. And of course, yesterday, Elizaveta Tukhtomushova took her first ever gold medal on the Grand Prix Series. Akiko Suzuki with the silver medal. And there is the American with the bronze. 1-2-3 at Skate Canada International. We'll wrap up the pairs portion when we come back. Some of the best skaters in the world, including the world silver medalists in pairs, on the ice right now here at the Hershey Center in Mississauga, Ontario, rehearsing the gala portion, the Parade of Champions, and we'll have that for you next week on CTV. We still have the free dance. We're moving closer to that today. Tessa Virtue and Scott Moyer, the defending Olympic champions, currently the leaders. But we're continuing to recap what has been a very compelling week at Skate Canada International. It's early in the season, second event on the Grand Prix circuit. So a lot of skaters still have a little rust on them. Some skaters trying to peak towards later in the year. In the pairs competition, it looked like the world silver medalists had their A game.
Yes, they did, and fine material, particularly in the free program. And, you know, we talked about this Russian team, and of course, favorites for me in the past were the great Gordieva and Grinkovs, and Bolosochar and Trankov are following in the footsteps of the legendary Russian great pair teams. They also have wonderful personalities. They're mature skaters with a lot of heart, and it is going to be so fun to follow them going into Sochi Olympics.
Well, let's follow them yesterday. They skated in the final position, but the battle was on for silver and bronze, and it featured a Canadian team as well of Duhamel and Radford. But let's go to the Chinese pairs team yesterday as they skated for a medal here in Mississauga. Nate, but I think, Tracy, you gave that Russian team the ultimate compliment. And you've seen a lot of skating. Yes. When you said they could become your second favorite Russian team behind Gordieva and Grinkov, that is an enormous compliment.
Terrific personalities. And it's, like I said at the top, it's going to be so much fun just to watch them progress. And these two are hungry.
Megan Duhamel and Eric Radford, the Canadian pairs champions, Kristen Moore Towers and Dylan Moskovich, competed last week at Skate America. They were not here, but Duhamel and Radford are going to give them a run at the Nationals.
Well, both teams came away from their first Grand Prix with bronze medals, so that's setting up a wonderful showdown. And with Moore Towers and Moskovich, they finished second in the free program, beating out the famous Chinese team, the Zhongs. So we've got two fine teams at at the beginning of the season that are really setting up a nice rivalry as this season progresses.
We're setting up the free dance, getting ready for that today. This was yesterday when they handed out the medals. Olesojar and Trankov, their first ascent to the gold medal Grand Prix podium. Nice one for them in the new season. And Megan DeHamel, Eric Radford, they were very proud of their bronze medal that they got yesterday. When we come back, we're going to look back at the men's competition from last night, and we'll also talk with the world champion, Patrick Chan.
And as we come back to the Hershey Center in Mississauga on this Sunday afternoon, still to come, free dance. Andrew Poggi, his partner Caitlin Weaver, based in Waterloo, Ontario. Big story there, second to the favorites Virtue and Moyer. That is all still to come. Joining me now, the bronze medalists from the pairs, Megan DeHamel and Eric Radford. Now, first of all, I want to get some geography in here. You're from Lively, Ontario. Where's that?
Just a small community outside of Sudbury.
All right, and I said you're from Balmerton, but you said no, it's Balmertown.
Balmertown, yeah.
Where's that?
It's the furthest north you can go by road in Ontario. It's about 5 hours north of Winnipeg and 6 hours north of Thunder Bay.
How in the heck did you get into skating up there?
I saw it on TV, which was the only way I would, you know, ever see it. And I was drawn to it, and I just started it from there.
How did you two get together? Because you were both junior Canadian singles champions in different years. You've had multiple partners. How did you come together, Megan?
Well, Eric and I have known each other for many years. We went to our very first international competition together in Chicago in 2001. So we've traveled the world together for singles with various partners.
Right.
And growing, skating in Northern Ontario. Obviously, we knew each other since a very young age. And in 2010, Eric and I were both happened to be training with the same coaches. And at that point, my previous partner had decided to retire. I was contemplating retirement. And our coaches suggested that maybe we should give it a try and do a tryout. So we were very open-minded to, you know, a second chance in our skating careers, and we're very lucky we took it.
Well, you should tell the viewers at home, by the way, that is rehearsal for the gala, the music down on the ice below. All right, you get together. You're seventh at the Worlds, you're fifth here last year, but you know where I'm going. The broken nose. Tell me how it happened. It was, well, your first attempt, wasn't it?
It was the first element in our first program at our first Worlds. And it just came down a little funny. She knocked me in the nose. And
with what?
With her elbow.
Yeah.
It's strong.
It's a strong.
Yeah. It's something that's happened before in practice where she's knocked me in the nose, but never that bad. And from the look on her face, I could tell something was wrong right away. And she just, her eyes were wide open, and I could see just out of the corner of my eye that, you know, I could see my nose over here a little bit. And so initially there was a panic, and our side-by-side jump was next. And going into that, you know, my eyes were filling with tears from the pain. And I just remember thinking, oh, this isn't fair. Like, that I have to do this jump, and I you know, I don't get a good shot at it because I can't see and everything, but we just kept going. Somehow.
But you continued, and we have it here, they're telling me right now, so let's take a look.
Yeah, that was a hard hit.
Yeah, really?
I remember after that, when I saw Eric's face, I was like, you can do it. You could still do your jump. It's okay. Everything's okay. And I was saying it as we stroke from one end of the ice to the other.
It's just amazing you were able to continue. Speaking of continuing, last year the adrenaline, that could happen from adrenaline. You seem to have settled in this year. Am I right?
Yeah, I think last year we knew we had so much potential and we had so much possibility as a team. And at the beginning of the year, we got really caught up in that. And maybe we were overexcited about it. Maybe our expectations were too high at the beginning of the year, and we really struggled a little bit. But now we're a lot more comfortable with each other. We have choreography we're comfortable with. We're confident, and we trust each other more. And it's very calm and settling now as opposed to last year.
All right, you're talking about calm, comfort.
Yeah.
But when I do research, I read where Eric says, you're the extrovert, and you say, no, he's more competitive. What's the story here?
Well, he is. We're both competitive.
Right.
We're both competitive.
Yeah, we're both very competitive, but I think we just show it in different ways. I'm more introverted competitive, and, you know, you read Megan's face when we're out there on the ice. You know, she's super excited, or the disappointment if we have a bad skate.
Well, I tell you what you are. You're awfully tough. Congratulations, a bronze medal
you.
Here. Good luck. We'll see
Thank
you in Moncton
so
at the Canadians. Well done. Stay
you.
With us. Lots more to come. We have the free dance competition here at the Hershey Center in Mississauga. Canadians standing 1-2. Thank you to Megan and Eric.
Final medals to be awarded on this ice surface behind me at the Hershey Center in Mississauga. The free dance still to come. We're continuing to look back at this marvelous start to the skating season. Last week, Skate America. This week, Skate Canada. One more competition to show you, and that, of course, was the men's event.
Well, and all Canadian eyes were on Patrick Chan because he was in third place after the short program. Very, very surprising. He had to try and overtake another world champion in Daisuke Takahashi from Japan. At the talk of the competition, though, in the short program was Javier Fernandez of Spain, who blew the roof off this arena and just skated the program of his life in the short program. He was going to have to, though, contend with closing the show, a position he'd never been in before. He's only ranked 10th in the world.
Well, Patrick Chan, as many of you who follow skating know, has adopted the quadruple jump over the last season. It's also helped make him a world champion. And Kurt Browning started it, Elvis Stoiko perfected it, and now Patrick Chan has used the quad as a piece of his arsenal.
It wasn't reluctance or fear. It's that there's always a time and place for everything.
Three quads in April at the World Championships in Moscow was his time.
The quad is a funny jump. It is extremely difficult and quite controversial. For me, the quad is more of a personal fulfillment. Going into it, you can feel the hush over the audience and just waiting for that big jump. And of course, the points are a big plus.
What a magical performance and the best overall score ever.
93.02 points in the short program, 187.96 points in the long program, 280.98 points overall, all world records. Now the one to beat. What will Patrick Chan do for an encore?
I actually don't have no clue how to beat myself. The points were so astronomically high that I was speechless. Being world champion and walking into this new season is a big relief for me, because I don't have anything to prove. I don't have anything to show. My motto is to constantly try something new. This season, I've been learning to incorporate modern dance. I've changed because I don't think about the jumps. I think more about how am I gonna impress and move the audience.
There's a seamless, natural, organic quality to Patrick's skating that is unmatched in the skating world. He's one of the few skaters who gives me goosebumps.
Chan has changed the landscape of men's skating in one season. He's forced his adversaries to add at least one quad to their programs just to compete. In between jumps, his skating is transition-rich and more complex than any other. What may be even more impressive, however, is at the age of 20, Chan is more determined.
I'm actually nervous for this.
More focused.
We try to do something, work more with the natural rhythm of my body.
And more driven to take his sport to another level and create a figure skating legacy of his own.
He really is something special. I don't think we've had such a well-rounded skater since Browning, and he's so unbelievable now with the quad jumps. He's a machine.
I want to be in the ranks of the best in your sport. For example, Tiger Woods or Roger Federer. They constantly are tweaking things to become better and better and become a dynasty. Last season, I broke three world records and won the world championships on top of that. So, and plus with doing the quads and everything, now I can really just enjoy what I'm doing.
Got their medals last night. And how good does it feel for Javier Fernandez, first time to get on that podium? And I'm sure not the last. There they are, the medalists in the men's competition. Free dance straight ahead. We'll talk with the champ.
All right, thank you, Rod. I am indeed joined by the gold medalist from last night. Congratulations to Patrick Chan.
Thank you.
I'll talk about the space you're in right now. Okay. You seem so confident, but let me go back to following Vancouver, the Olympics. Mm-hmm. By your own admission, you're down, you come in injured. Yet a year later, you not only win a world championship, mm-hmm. you make history with the quads. What motivated you?
Two things. First of all, I had all the tools, actually before the Olympics. I had a new trainer, new coach, new training regimen, basically. I just didn't have the time to get it in place and trained on repetition and doing it over and over. And then the second thing is that I went to the Olympics with the wrong mindset, I believe. And truly, you do learn from the Olympics, a lifetime of lessons, because even if you win a medal or you don't, you learn a lesson. And that was that, you know, skating is more than just winning and becoming famous and getting all these rewards and so on. It's about really having a passion for what you do and finding that passion again, because that just pushes you beyond what anyone can believe.
But you have found the passion. I mentioned when we came on how I've seen you for years. You seem to be in a better place. Am I right on that?
I'm much more relaxed, and I really have become able to enjoy what I do on the ice. I don't feel nervous or pressured to do anything. I'm really out there because I love what I do. You know, Sidney Crosby said it best. You know, what can be better than getting paid to do what you love to do? And this is what I love to do, is to perform and be able to just unleash my emotion and my soul onto the ice and into the audience.
Good friend of mine, I worked with her in the Turin Olympics, Lori Nickel, has choreographed your program. Tracy Wilson remarked last night that for the first time, you really seem, I guess, one with the music
with the
is
music.
The best way.
Yeah. And that's a matter of experience. I've been at the World Championships, I think, three times so far, and I've had a world champion medal on my shoulder. So to have that with me, it helps me relax, and I have nothing to... I don't have no pressure to win anything. I was saying last night at the press conference with Daisuke by my side, I said, you know, when myself and Daisuke were at the point where we're not looking to win another world championship. We're not looking to necessarily beat the records or anything, because we're just there to entertain. And you can tell in the way we skate, we just want to be there to entertain the audience.
But it's also like you have nothing to prove. I mean, you came out here last night. You could have done an easy program, could have done it clean, but you go to a higher level. You didn't always do that.
It's the exhilaration you get from pushing the bar. My ultimate goal is to push the sport where it's never been pushed before, and being a pioneer in my sport and be remembered for being the first one to do two quads or three quads in the program. I don't know what it is, but just something different so that people will remember me and really change the sport so that when I leave the sport, it'll be different from when I came into it.
And that will not be for several years. You'll be in Sochi. We will see you in January in Moncton in the Canadiens.
Correct. Can't wait.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
That is Patrick Chan. Stay with us. Lots more to come. Still to come, the free dance competition this afternoon here at the 2011 Skate Canada International. And we are just a few minutes away from the free dance, the Olympic 2010 World Champions, Tessa Virtue, Scott Moyer. The other big story for Canada, Caitlin Weaver and Andrew Poget, based in Waterloo, Ontario, are standing second. Free dance still to come gives us a chance to talk with the Chief Executive Officer of Skate Canada, William Thompson. Thank you for joining me.
Oh, thank you for having me.
I'm not sure people realize, we talk about the sport being cyclical, but, you know, when we came here Friday, three great stories.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, you know, our big goal is to move away from being cyclical. In fact, you interviewed me a number of years ago when I was first starting, and you said to me maybe you'd been a little complacent. And so what we've dedicated ourselves to over this past 5 years is to have no complacency and to develop ourselves quickly. So now we have Tessa and Scott, fabulous story of 2010 games, the whole thing. Patrick Chan, who has now really elevated himself above the world. But what I'm really excited is to start to see the young ones coming. Andre Rogozin, junior men's champion. Good first Grand Prix, good competitor, strong competitor, doesn't buckle under the pressure, really like that. Caitlin Weaver, Andrew Poget, big step up this year as well. I mean, but we're not there. We still have work to do in ladies. We recognize it, and our pairs are coming along. but we're going in the right direction.
Talk to me about marketing. I spoke with Debbie Wilkes. I mean, this is not just figure skating. This is all Olympic sports. In fact, sports in general. The calendar is so crowded today. It's a very different world.
Sure. It's very difficult to set yourself apart from the, you know, all the options out there, not to mention the non-sport options, the, you know, charity things and all this stuff going on, festivals. But I think we have a bit of a unique product. It's really geared towards women. It's the only sport that combines really artistry and physical strength. And for us, I think, we, you know, we're going the right direction. We have a big membership. We're getting close with some sponsorships, and it will come. And obviously, our long-term deal with CTV and TSN Group has been huge for us because it's given us a solid platform, media platform to work from.
All right, skaters on the ice, but I got one more question for you. Where does Skate Canada go next year?
Next year, we're going to Windsor, Ontario, which is going to be terrific because it's right on that battle zone between Canada and the U.S., where those ice dancers train in Canton, Michigan.
Canton, Michigan, the World Center for Ice Dance Training. William Thompson, CEO, thank you.
Thank you. Good luck.
We'll see you in Moncton in late January for the Canadian Championships. We'll take a break. Skaters are on the ice, and as promised, it is the free dance from the 2011 Skate Canada International. You're going to love this coming up after this break.
Rivals, fellow countrymen, pushing each other to get better and better. So far, it's been a complete success.
Ice dance could not be in better shape in this country.
Olympic champions Virtue and Moyer lead the way.
I guess that's why they're Olympic champions.
Their highly anticipated Funny Face program set to debut. Close behind Weaver and Pojan.
Magnificent!
How will the dance competition unfold? Skate Canada International is next. What a way to spend a Sunday afternoon inside the Hershey Center in Mississauga as we anticipate the free dance here, final medals to be awarded. The 2011 Skate Canada International. Canada, the United States, Italy, and Russia all competing here. Here are the numbers after the short program. The ice dance, short dance, Virtue and Moyer 71-61, Weaver and Pogge in second, Capellini and Lenotte of Italy in third spot, 1-2-3, and the Canadian dance team of Tara Harvey and Keith Gagnon currently in seventh place. They'll skate first.
Represent Canada. Please welcome Tara Harvey and Keith Gagnon.
This is a team that has been together for a number of years, 14 to be exact. They grew up together. Not a lot of international experience, some on the junior level. This, their first senior Grand Prix. Skating to a medley of Rolling Stones. You're going to find a lot of variety in this dance event. One of the required elements in the free dance, and look at the speed they're carrying. These are called twizzles. The highest levels gets up to 6 points. Other required elements, 5 lifts, a spin, and 2 step sequences. Here's a look at their step sequence, and this is a technical part where the judges are looking for the difficult turns, strong edges, keeping the rhythm of the dance. notice with a lot of the dance teams, there's quite a bit of a height difference between the man and the woman. With these two, there is not, so that makes lifts a lot more challenging for them. I think they're handling it nicely. They went to the floor this summer working with an acrobat to try to help them fine-tune their lifts. So they go through a footwork sequence here. I think they're having fun with the music. His background is dance, hers is sport.
Nice. Coached by Megan Wing and Aaron Lowe, who did not have a big height difference between the two of them as well. Aaron's here, Megan's at home. They're new baby twins. Nicely done. Tara Harvey, Keith Gagnon of Canada. Gotta like starting a show off with the Rolling Stones. That's what we're talking about. First of three Canadian teams with their coach, Aaron Lowe. Congratulations to the new papa. He and his wife, Megan. Proud parents of twins 3 weeks ago, Kiana and Tayson. They are the Skate Canada Competitive Coaches of the Year, and why wouldn't they have twins?
Exactly.
And a boy and a girl.
Uh-oh.
Dancers.
I see a dance team coming up. These two very well prepared for this competition, opening with their twizzles that get a highest level, level four, base mark for that. This is an area that needs to be addressed, and you'll see the difference with the more senior teams and the world-class competitors later on. Leg unison needs to be refined, and they need to skate closer together, but taking full advantage of the fact that there's a very little height difference between them. Quite entertaining. I like the music. It was a fun piece. I think they got the bold rhythm of that dance and of the music. I think they need to explore some syncopation and some subtlety so they can really get the feeling across to the audience. I think they could play with the rhythm of that music a little bit more. They need a little bit more sort of shaking and moving going on with it.
There's the mark, 73.15 combined with the short program, 122.80. We'll follow that score for the next teams to come.
The next competitors represent the United States of America. Please welcome Madison Shaw and Evan Bates.
Two skaters who are part of that ice dance factory. Marina Zueva and Igor Spielman. Of course, Tessa Virtue and Scott Moyer are there, and Davis and White. And every day, these guys get on the ice, and they're competing against the best in the world and skating with them. Here's Madison Chalk and Evan Bates of the United States.
Skating to classical jazz. They had a fall at the end of their short dance, which has them down in the standings in sixth place. These two, if you can believe it, have only been skating together for 4 months. Both junior world champions with different partners. And you can see there is a dramatic difference between the two of them. And they've both gone from partners with that were similar sizes to now having to work with the height difference. Nice line on that lift. Gonna have to rework their technique a little bit and style to make their skating styles blend completely. fluid skaters. They've had quite a bit of experience at the senior level internationally. In fact, Madison was ninth in the world last year with her partner Greg Zuerlein, and you can just see the qualities evident in their flow across the ice. There, keeping the character of the music.
Much better ending to the free dance than that short program. Madison Chalk and Evan Bates, very soft and lilting and very smooth. We saw Igor Spielman, Marina Zueva, their coaches of Virtue and Moyer, who also will skate and will skate last today. Katarina Puskash and Jonathan Guerrero will be the final team to skate in this first flight. They are on the ice, the Russians. Madison Chalk and Evan Bates of the United States. We await their marks, two former world junior champions, but not together with other partners.
And can you believe how well they've been able to handle this competition? Poor Marina. Choked up by their performance, maybe? No. Okay. You can see their strengths as individuals in the way they have wonderful technique, leg extension, flow across the ice. You see the curves that they make, no tension on the blade. Really liked the positions in this dance spin. Very jazzy, keeping the character of the music. And that's a hard piece of music to work with. It's a piece of music that is, it's so subdued, and you could hear sort of the calm in the audience. Doesn't create a lot of excitement. They handled it very well. Now, as the season progresses, they've only been together 4 months, they've got to get some complexity in there. This is a team that wants to earn one of the top three spots at U.S. Nationals and get to the World Championships. They just have to keep building. They got a lot to work with.
This is a personal best because they've had no personal bests. They're a brand new team. And their overall score puts them in first place for the moment. 135.10.
The next competitors represent Russia. Please welcome Ekaterina Puskash and Jonathan Guerrero.
Freshly minted world junior silver medalists. Katarina Puskash, Jonathan Guerrero.
And they are new to senior competition, so for them it's trying to establish themselves as senior competitors. Skating two variations on a theme of Paganini. like the musicality in that footwork sequence. They were using the syncopation well throughout it, and that's not easy in that required element. They're struggling somewhat on their lift. That's where you see a little bit of their junior side as they move from one position to the other. It's not quite seamless. And Rod, at this point, what you want to do when you're moving from juniors to seniors, you want to do something that sort of sets you apart, that gets you noticed. Kind of a dance team are you? And they're following in the Russian dramatic style. An area they really have to work on is from the waist down, and that's the detail of their free legs and their pushing foot. You watch when their legs leave the ice, they don't extend and create a line. They will do that here, though, in this footwork sequence. Watch here, the free leg, the leg in the air, has a nice straight point and turnout. Focusing on this section because the judges award marks for difficulty and quality there. It's the skating in between the elements they really have to refine. So if you look at the skating here with the bent free legs, that has to be smoothed out and worked on.
So reminiscent of so many Russian teams, that classic dramatic style, Pushkash and Guerrero, coached by a couple of legendary Russians in Linichuk and Kapanasov.
And this is a style that dance is moving away from, I have to say. And I'm getting a lot of people coming up to me and saying how much they like the new direction of ice dance. It's dance, it's rhythm, and we have Virtua Moyer's coaches, Marina and Igor, to thank for leading the sport in this direction.
There they are. Tessa and Scott, Virtua and Moyer with Marina Zueva making their way to the ice. Final four teams to come, two Canadian teams, Italian team, and another Russian team. There's Scott Moyer. He and partner Tessa Virtue up against Caitlin Weaver and Andrew Poggi. Gold and silver. Canada in those two top spots right now. Katerina Pushkash, Jonathan Guerrero. Guerrero was actually born in Australia. His mother, Svetlana Liapina, used to skate with Gorsha Sur. And he was born there and raised there while his mother was coaching there.
One of the areas they really have to work on, the lifts. You can see here struggling for position. And nothing was sort of intentional. It was a little bit of desperation at that point. Early in the season, that's what happened. It's the point of the free leg, the extension of the leg. It's creating pictures and moments within the dance. This was a little bit ragged. It does need some refinement, especially from the waist down.
The scores, please, for Ivana.
Here come the scores.
And Jonathan Guerrero of Russia.
19-year-old Ekaterina, Jonathan is 20. Again, just fresh to the senior ranks.
5.39 with a total score of 126.63.
126.63.
Are currently in second place.
So they fall to second place. Chalk and Bates are our current leaders at 135.10. So we've had some movement in this first group. Madison Chalk and Evan Bates of the United States lead. Coming up, we have Zinova and Kachenko, Capellini, Lenotte, Weaver and Poggi, and Virtue and Moyer.
final group in free dance on the ice. Just a reminder, next Saturday night, 7:30 Eastern, 4:30 Pacific, the gala from here at Skate Canada on TSN. Still to come, Tessa Virtue and Scott Moyer. Now, Virtue and Moyer today, and you're in for a treat, will skate to music from an old movie. I remember saying to Tessa, why an old movie? She said, the answer is simple. I am basically an old soul.
Tessa and I are skating to music from the motion picture Funny Face, which is an Audrey Hepburn and Fred Astaire movie, and it's one of Tessa's all-time favorites.
It's the story that could only happen in Paris.
The story involves Fred Astaire finding Audrey Hepburn in a bookstore, and he decides that she should be the cover girl for a magazine, and she doesn't necessarily think that she fits the role.
I don't want my hair cut. I don't want my eyebrows up or down. I want them right where they are.
When I see Audrey act, I kind of think of Tessa and kind of the same mannerisms and, you know, how polite and cutesy they are, and, you know, you can draw a lot of parallels.
I find I relate to Audrey's character in the movie because I don't always have the confidence, or I don't necessarily believe that I was really born to be an ice dancer. And I'm so lucky that I have a partner like Scott who can reassure me and we can have fun together on the ice.
Tessa is so sweet. She's my biggest fan and she's always there to support me. She has a side to her that not very many people know.
People have always told me that I'm a bit of an old soul. I love classic movies. I love old music. there's so much about me that I feel sometimes I'm trapped in this 22-year-old's body. It's fun to kind of take that onto the ice with me. And, you know, of course, we're developing this program that's around this older movie.
We're trying to make it genuine. When you try and make a program like a movie, you have to, you know, resemble it in a certain way.
It's been so fun to watch Scott evolve as this character of Fred Astaire. He loves getting into character. He loves, you know, just the way Fred moves.
Watching him dance is quite something. The way he kind of leads all of his co-stars, you really find yourself watching them, and it's mostly because he's shaping them so well. I kind of look at that and try and do the same thing with Tess.
It's the first time we've really been able to play character roles directly from the movie, which is fun for us. And I hope people don't see Tess and Scott on the ice. I hope they see Audrey and Fred.
When I watch the movie Funny Face, I get like a warm feeling inside. And it's a very simple storyline, just about love and about these two people falling in love. And we want to make people in the stands feel that.
Funny Face, circa 2011. Tessa Virtue and Scott Moyer will unveil it for us today.
Going through the last moments of their warm-up, skating on their own, just getting a feel for the legs, for the ice.
The ultimate compliment would be to be compared to a Fred Astaire, would it not? As a dancer?
No question. He's drawing that comparison.
Well, Fred and Audrey will be last. Weaver and Poggé before them. Capellini Lenotte. Again, they skate in reverse order here. Madison Chalk and Evan Bates of the United States lead. The Russians will be first. Fourth place after the short dance.
Ladies and gentlemen, the next competitors represent Russia. Please welcome Ekaterina Ryazanova and Ilya Kachenko.
Ryazanova and Kachenko. Russia's silver medalists. Again, a team that has played musical partners in the past and come together in a short time to form quite a bond.
And they've competed for two seasons on the Senior Grand Prix circuit, but as yet they have no world experience. At the senior ranks, they were sixth at the European Championships, and they are trying to climb to the top of Russia so they can make it to Worlds.
Mm-hmm.
Skating to Romance from Snowstorm. She has a beautiful back, lovely expressive arms. The story they tell is one where she dreams of being with a past love, but in the end, it's only a dream. Nice speed going into this diagonal step sequence. Twizzle section coming up. Again, good speed and ice coverage. Very good unison. Throughout this circular step sequence, particularly in the free leg line. And that's something that is going to affect the quality of this element.
Problems with synchronization. Ekaterina Ryazanova and Ilya Kachenko of Russia.
No major errors, but problems with some of the marks for quality, as you said, Rod. Still, early in the season, a good first effort.
Three dance teams to come, the Italians. Then it will be Canada on ice. Virtue and Moyer last, but before them, Andrew Poggi and Caitlin Weaver. Once upon a time, that's how it began for so many skaters. Get them while they're young.
Stands watching.
Get them while they're young. That's what they've done with the Russian women lately. And now the Russian dance team is trying to rise up as well. Here's Ryazanova and Kochenko.
One of their more effective lifts. I really like the line they created in the opening segment, but you can see when they came out of the lift, the sloppy free legs. There's no point to the toe, no definition. Watch here, watch the free legs, her feet in the air. There's not a pretty position throughout that lift, and that has to be addressed because it's just not up to the world standard, and that's what they're going to have to work on if they're to get to the World Championships. Again here, free leg unison problems, the circular step sequence. You don't see the strong matching line of the free leg. They're always bent. There's not a lot of definition with the turnout or feel of the free foot. And that's something, Rod, that in the past, the Russians were known for that. I used to marvel at how they did it, and I used to watch the Russians to try and learn from it, because a lack of pointed toes was my weakness back in the day. But anyways, that's something that, for whatever reason, I think with the new system and the technical difficulty, the Russians have not been able to grasp.
Everybody's learning from these guys now.
Well, and every move they make creates the perfect shot, the perfect picture.
The scores, please, for Katarina.
Tessa and Scott backstage, gearing up. Three teams to come. Here are the marks. Score to beat is 135.10. And 2 points on deductions. Ryazanova and Kochenko fall down from fourth into second place right now, and Madison Chalk and Evan Bates are the leaders.
And Harvey and Gagnon have the second highest technical score, so that bodes very well for the new Canadian team.